how to get the audience to love him and stuff like that.
But Little Richard also stood out and caught the ear of young America by building his hits on a rhythm that deviated from the standard R&B swing beat that was the foundation of rock and roll.
Little Richard's beats are, I would even say, radically different from, like, Bill Haley in the Comets, which is a very swing beat. It's done rock around the clock tonight, you know, that sort of, that just, you know, the emphasis is on the two and the four, one, two, three, four, like that. Whereas Lucille is, and it hits on every, on the one and the three.
It's just something you feel. It feels exciting.
Lucy, you won't do your sister's will. Lucy, you won't do your sister's will.
I remember one day, Richie was looking at me. This guy got something in his mind. He said, Charles, we're going to the train station in Macon, Georgia on 5th Street. We're going to follow this train as it move along. And we're just gonna listen to the sound of the train. I say, okay. And the train picked up speed, so it went cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. He said, Joe. I said, what? He said, what kind of notes are those? I said, Richard, those are 8 notes. He said, when we have rehearsal tomorrow at my house, I want you to play that beat behind me, and I'm gonna be playing the same thing on piano. I say, okay. Sound like a damn earthquake.
Lucy, please come back where you belong.
And of course, the way they used to record with one or two microphones up in the air, it just sounds like all one thing. And that just has a way of getting at you. It sort of marks out the way that teenagers felt at the time. You know, what are you rebelling against? I don't know, what do you got? But we're going to do it, and we're going to do it now.
While trains inspired Little Richard, America in the 50s was a nation expanding its love affair with the car. The auto industry gaining power through government closure of public transport and a massive plan to extend America's highways.
This is the American dream of freedom on wheels. An automotive age traveling on time-saving superhighways.
Cars were like a major part of the culture, drag racing and teenagers going out in their own cars. This wasn't happening before.
Well, there's plenty of speed here.
The design of cars changed as well, with more powerful engines like the mass-produced V8 Ford and styling taking on chrome plating, two-tone colors, and rocket age streamlining and fins.
Sam Phillips recorded a record by Jackie Brenston called Rocket 88.
V8 motor in this smart and designed black convertible top and the gals don't mind. Sporting with me,
Rocket 88 was a model of Oldsmobile car.
Blow your horn, Raymond, blow.
It was the first American car that had two-tone colors. Blue, I remember a powder blue and a navy blue, and that in the ghetto was hot stuff, like new Nikes would be today.
The whole idea of a love song to the car, I'm gonna pick you up for a date, we're gonna be free to be ourselves, go where we wanna go, do what we wanna do, and no one has to know.
Step in my rocket and don't be late, baby, we are pulling out about half past eight. Going round the corner and...
The next car record to ride high in the charts came from an unlikely source. A 28-year-old ex-hairdresser with an ear for blues and country, going by the name of Chuck Berry, who in the summer of 55 motivated up the migrant corridor from St. Louis to Chicago and Chess Records.
In the wee wee hours.
With a blues song called Wee Wee Hours.
That's when I think of you.
But what caught the ear of label head Leonard Chess was not Chuck's blues, but the other song on his demo. An adaptation of Bob Wills' Western swing song, Ida Red.
My family was always looking for what was new and cutting edge. You know, my father's nickname was the Foot Stomper, so I know his foot started going.
And at Chess Records, Chuck's song went through a rewrite, starting with its title.
Lamp on the table, a picture on the wall, that's a pretty sofa, and that's not all.
As I was motivating over the hill, I saw Maybelline in a coupe de ville. A Cadillac rolling on an open road, nothing I'd run my V8-4.
The story goes that in the studio, there was a Maybelline cosmetic package. They came up with the name Maybelline, and they recorded it.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done started back doing the thing you used to do.
Chuck Berry is the Shakespeare of rock and roll.
Cadillac pulled up to 104 before got a hot and wouldn't do no.
Maybelline is about him chasing a beautiful woman who's in a Cadillac and he's trying to catch up with her.
Rainwater blowing all under my hood. I knew that was doing my motor good. Maybelline, why can't you be true?
He was talking about the wind was coming in, the rain was coming down, but all that could be good for his motor. He said, keep it cool off, because he's driving so fast, you know? Then he happened to look out his window, and she was right there, too.
The motor cooled down, the heat went down, and that's when I heard that highway sound.
What a story, what a mind.
110 a half a mile ahead. Cadillac looking like it's setting still, and I caught Maybelline at the top of the hill. Maybelline!
There's a kind of ambiguity there, because you don't know if she's a white girl or a black girl. Also, there's a class dimension. He's driving a V8 Ford, and she's driving a Cadillac Coupe de Ville. That's a rich person's car. You know, that's dangerous. In 1955, that's really dangerous.
Chuck Berry, I think, is the best rock and roll songwriter. I don't think there was anybody like him before. He came up with a different word for every note. There was a word for each note, which was not like blues records. Chuck Berry doesn't repeat. It's like, deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, we're back up in the woods among the evergreens. They stood a log cabin made of earth and wood, where lived a country boy named Johnny B. Good, who never ever learned to read or write so well, but he could play the guitar just like a ringing a bell. I mean, that's a whole story right there. And then, go, 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 Johnny, go. So that's when he comes into the chorus, but every note is a word.
Deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, we're back up in the woods among the evergreens. There stood a log cabin made of earth and wood, where lived a country boy named Johnny B. Good, who never ever learned to read or write so well, but he could play a guitar just like a ringing a bell. Go, 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 Johnny, go, go, go.
Before Chuck Berry, most everybody strummed their guitars in a delicate manner. And all of a sudden, here comes Chuck Berry, man, and he's kicking butt, and he's not strumming, he's hitting that baby.
It didn't have to play just one role as just being a music maker. It was a personality that he would play with.
But Chuck was no spring chicken. He'd been round the block and cut an almost avuncular figure in this white teenage world.
I was very young. I was 13 when Chuck Berry came to Chess. In my eyes, he was extraordinarily eccentric. One day, my dad said, take Chuck across the street, buy him some lunch. We sat down in the booth, and he ordered strawberry shortcake as a starter, and the main course after, It was just, he's just a very unique individual. He had robbed a gas station. He had done jail time when he was a teenager. You know, he had knew the hard knocks of it. But as I grew older, I was fascinated how he knew what was happening with white teenagers riding around in an automobile. Black teenagers weren't driving cars in 1955. It was before civil rights. That's the thing about Chuck. He was very highly motivated to make it. Somehow he was able to tap into what white teenagers were doing, their lifestyle, how much different they're living than the black kids. That's the market. That's what I want to get into.
Chuck was able to see the teenage experience and sing a song directly to your experience.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chuck Berry, Sweet Little 16.
Sweet Little 16, she's got the grown-up blues. Tight dresses and lipstick, she's sporting high heel shoes. Oh, but tomorrow morning,
she'll have to change her trim and be sweet 16 and back in class again.
Chuck's songs were the first to explore the teen experience, catching the moment a young America walked a line between parental control and dolled up, libidinous, four on the floor freedom on a highway to who knows where. Despite being hatched in a divided country, the music through stealth and accident had stolen the soul of young America.
Cause they'll be rocking on bandstand in Philadelphia, PA.
Just
Revless.
And they're off. Up to the halfway mark, they're neck and neck. 170.45 miles per hour.
1950s America, where teenagers enjoyed a share of a turbocharged good life.
There's the Allison against the thin Chevy. You can't see it for the smoke, but the Chevy won.
And kids now found themselves with money to burn.
Elvis explained this to my dad and I. He said, we've always aimed our songs and record sales to adults. But he says, you see the kids that are coming out to the show. They have their own money. They're buying the records. And they're the ones that'll make it happen for you. So you've got to do their type of songs.
If few deals are more than 20%. That's it. That's an artist-manager split. The Colonel, he had a 50-50 relationship with Elvis till the day he died. He was a mysterious sort of a guy. There were things about the Colonel that I don't think anybody will ever know.
He was a self-made Southern Colonel. He had jumped ship. He was an illegal alien. He was a Dutchman. He did something bad because he didn't go back. Some people say he may have killed somebody there.
Before he signed Elvis, he was like a traveling salesman almost.
Dr. Mayfield's wonderful Vitazone remedy brings a new spring to your walk. Oh, I see.
He promoted different medications and all kinds of stuff.
A sample of the marvelous freaks you'll see if you hurry, hurry, hurry.
He was doing these country fairs. He sent someone out to buy some little chickens, and he had music playing Turkey in the Straw and the electric hot plate, and they were pulling their feet up and because they were burning their feet. And that was the Colonel's famous dancing chickens.
Let's get real, real gone for a change. Well, I woke up this morning and I looked out the door. I can tell an old milk cow. I can tell the way she's alone if you see my milk cow.
In early 55, the Colonel was just an advisor to Elvis, not even his manager. With no exclusive rights over Sun Records' local star.
Tom Parker started running around the country saying that Elvis Presley's contract was for sale, which was not true. And my dad got wind of it. He called him and said, man, you know, what the hell are you doing? Elvis' contract's not for sale. Tom Parker said, well, would you sell him? You know, would you ever sell him? And my dad said, well, if the price was right. And when he said that, he was thinking in his mind, what the price I would ask, nobody would pay for that, for Elvis Presley. Nobody would. And he said, well, what's the price? And my dad said, $35,000, which at that time was the highest contract ever that anybody ever been bought for.
Colonel wanted stuff his way, period. You couldn't beat him at his own game. He could out-talk you. He could out-think you. He's a pretty smart guy, really.
Train I ride. 16 coaches long.